HOD Professor Dr. V. Lakshmi Kumarani ma'am and Professor Dr. T. Srinivasan sir for this opportunity. My case. Mr. X, 62-year-old gentleman. He is farmer by occupation, hailing from Tirupur with complaints of ulcer over back of left thigh for past 6 months. Before 6 months, he developed small blisters over back of left thigh.
Okay, Kavi, can you make it full screen?
Yes, sir. Is it visible, sir?
Now good to go, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Before 6 months, he developed small blisters over back of left thigh, which was broken, and it turned into a small ulcer, which was smaller in size for past 4 months, and sudden increase in size of ulcer was noted over period of 2 months to become present size ulcer. History of foul smelling discharge present. No history of pain over ulcer. No history of fever. No history of trauma. No history of difficulty in walking. No history of any painful swelling over the left groin region. History of loss of appetite present. History of significant loss of weight present. Past history, he is not known diabetic hypertensive. He doesn't have any other comorbidities. No history of myocardial infarction, stroke, peripheral vascular disease in this past. No history of previous surgeries. Personal history, he consumes non-vegetarian diet. His smoking index 20 pack here. He is occasional alcoholic. Family history, no history of similar illness in his family members. To summarize history, 60-year-old gentleman came with ulcer over back of left thigh for past 6 months. Sudden increase in size of ulcer was noted for past 4 months. Foul smelling discharge from the ulcer present. My provisional diagnosis, chronic non-healing ulcer, probably malignant etiology with secondary infection. Shall I proceed, sir?
No, please. Wait a minute. Sorry, I don't get your name. Why do you think this is malignant? Just 6 months? What do you mean by a chronic ulcer? What do you mean by a chronic ulcer?
Sir, yes, sir. The ulcer that is not showing a sign of healing for 3 weeks or right. More, sir.
So in 6 months, it can be an unstable scar. It can be just a chronic ulcer, which is not a non-healing ulcer. Why do you think it's malignant? Just because?
Sir, because it has sudden increase in size for past 2 months, sir. And he had a loss of appetite and significant loss of weight for past 6 months, sir.
No, does squamous cell carcinoma give a history of loss of weight and loss of appetite? Do they? For an ulcer which is in the back of a thigh for 6 months, which is increasing in size suddenly, maybe, which is all anecdotal. You think? Just because of loss of weight and loss of appetite,
cancer hospital does not give place to that. Non-malignant anta avuto non-neoplastic anta.
So you can't just label it by history. That you can. The first part is chronic non-healing ulcer is fine. Etiology is you don't know. Squamous cell carcinoma. You think it's a squamous cell carcinoma, probably, isn't it? They are not seen de novo on a skin. But there's no transitional cell. There's no transition. At least squamous cell carcinoma is seen where there's transition, isn't it? Squamous to something else. And there's no signs. And why there's nothing? It doesn't have a history of injury, no chronic ulcers, no burns. I think you should be sure it is malignant etiology, secondary infection.
Okay, sir.
Right. Let's go back to your history again, please, right from beginning.
Yes, sir.
No difficulty in trauma, no painful. Has he had this ulcer before also? Was there an ulcer before also which had healed, or this is the first episode?
No, sir. He didn't have any recurrent episodes of ulcer, sir.
There was no scar there before? No scar?
No scar before, sir. No, sir. Okay.
Can I make a comment, sir?
Yes.
Please, sir. Please, sir.
Yeah, again, taking from where Raju sir left it. Your enthusiasm to label it as malignant, you probably brought in the concept of loss of weight and loss of appetite. Why do you think a leg ulcer of 4 months or 5 months duration should produce a loss of appetite and loss of weight. Do you have any explanation for that?
Sir, usually extremity cancers, skin cancers won't produce these symptoms, sir.
Yeah, that's what I think Rajiv sir also trying to tell you. In your enthusiasm to put it as the etiology to be malignant, you're unnecessarily bringing the concept of loss of weight and loss of appetite, because you want to say it as a malignant. That's fine. That may be your initial last diagnosis, but don't bring in loss of appetite, loss of weight. In a patient who has a leg ulcer, usually this kind of loss of appetite, loss of weight are seen in patients with aerodigestive malignancies or an advanced stage of malignancies like having a liver metastasis, ascites, peritoneal disease, etc. Usually, a leg ulcer of 6 months duration should not produce a loss of appetite, and there should not be a loss of weight unless it's a metastatic disease or something like that. But if it were a GI malignancy, esophagus, stomach, or pancreas, or anything of that sort, it would be there. Similarly, you said in next slide, you said there is no history of previous surgeries. Has it got anything to do with this particular disease, or you were just mentioning for the completion's sake?
Sir, if there is any previous lesion or lesion which was excised for biopsy.
Okay, then it would be a residual disease, no? Are you thinking in terms of this being a recurrent thing?
Sir, to inquire about it, I asked about this, sir.
Again, you brought in the concept of trauma. Why did you bring in no history of trauma? Was there a specific reason for mentioning no history of trauma in your presentation? Is it a traumatic ulcer?
No, sir. It's not a traumatic ulcer, sir.
Okay. What is the relation between trauma and malignancies of the soft tissues? Is trauma an etiological factor?
No, sir.
February 1st, no time to prepare.
Are you sure? Desmoids. Trauma is usually what is being mentioned is it's a factor which draws your attention to the area. But trauma can be an etiological factor also, like in desmoids. It's not your trivial trauma like your surgical trauma, scars. Malignancies can arise, soft tissue malignancies can arise in sites of trauma, like your desmoids. So your point of asking history of trauma is good. Two reasons. One, it draws the attention of the patient towards the lesion which is there. Second, trauma can be an etiological factor also. Okay. Thank you.
Kavi, I would have loved it if you had asked for any previous mole there. Was there any discoloration of the skin there? Anything which preceded that ulcer? Because I find it very difficult that an ulcer just happens there. Without any, look, squamous cell carcinoma needs some premalignant condition, some kind of irritation, some kind of thing. They don't usually arise de novo. You get me?
Okay, sir.
Unlike basal cell can arise de novo, but squamous cell usually does not arise de novo. It's got something in the back, in the back, which will give rise to it. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So can I ask you, Dr. Kavi Prabha?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Rajiv sir said something in the back. Can you tell some pre-malignant lesions?
Solar keratosis.
No. Listen carefully. Where is the lesion? In the thigh.
Sir, it is on left thigh, sir.
Posterior aspect. Do you think solar keratosis affects there? Solar keratosis. Try. Name some pre-malignant conditions. So what I want you to remember is... Sorry? I could not hear you.
Sir, my internet connection is interrupted, sir. I can't hear you, sir. Can you please repeat the question, sir?
My question is... Patient has a lesion in the posterior part of the thigh, so solar keratosis is unlikely, no? Correct?
Yes, sir.
No, no, I want you to understand, no history of any. Rajiv sir was talking to you about some chronic irritation sites, you know. That is what he was aiming at, any scar. No history of scar means burn scar or whatever it is. And no history of any plaques, skin lesions, including Bowen's disease or a xeroderma pigmentosa. Okay. So that's one sentence would have been enough. No pre-existing skin lesions. That is what he was talking. The precipitating factors. You know, albinism, Bowen's disease, xeroderma pigmentosa, these are all pre-malignant conditions, right? So in the absence of any one of those, what might have triggered? That is what everyone is interested to know in this patient to develop into it.
Sir, he is farmer by occupation, sir. So chronic sun exposure may lead on to this condition, sir.
Oh God. So that portion, thigh, posterior part of the thigh, I don't know. Dr. Madhu will probably clarify it later.
Some pesticide can happen, but I think it's posterior. This is the most protected part of the body, actually, posterior part of the thigh. Okay, sir.
See, is his profession such a profession that there is chronic irritation in that particular area? Because if you're a farmer, you would have irritations or chronic trauma at your upper arms, your lower limbs, below the ankle joint or something like that. This particular area is usually a protected area. So is he in some kind of profession where he has a recurrent trauma to that area or irritation to that area? Have you specifically asked for that?
No, sir.
You just mentioned he's a farmer. What type of a farmer, like? Fine, proceed.
Yes, sir. General physical examination. He's conscious oriented, thin built, moderately nourished. His weight 55 kg, height 170 cm, VMI 19. ECOG score 1, not pale, not ectric. Vital signs are normal. Local examination of thigh, ulcer of size 20 cm inspection, ulcer of size, inspection of left thigh. With the proper consent, with the proper informed consent, I examine the patient with the proper exposure. Ulcer of size 20 cm into 10 cm, located in the posterior aspect of left thigh, which is irregular in shape and irregular margin. Floor covered with granulation tissue and necrotic slough, edge averted and rolled out. Foul smelling, serosanguinous discharge with extensive slough noted over the upper and medial aspect of wound. Ulcer extends approximately from the gluteal fold to 5 cm above the knee region. Skin surrounding ulcer stretched and shiny and dilated veins seen. Multiple satellite nodules.
Show the picture first, then you explain the ulcer. Sorry to interrupt, Madhu.
Okay, ulcer, sir. Here, the skin is stretched and shiny with the dilated veins seen around the ulcer, and then multiple satellite nodules seen around the ulcer margin, sir. Palpation, ulcer of size 20 cm and 10 cm, located in the posterior aspect of left thigh, which has irregular shape with the irregular margin, floor covered with granulation tissue and slough. Ulcer is not mobile over the underlying deep structures. Ulcer extends up to 4 cm below the ischial tuberosity and inferiorly extends 5 cm above the knee joint. It bleeds on touch. Foul smelling discharge with extensive slough noted over upper middle aspect. Base of the ulcer is indurated. Edge is also indurated. Induration extends and involves 1 cm surrounding skin also. Peripheral pulses of both limbs normally felt. No sensorineural deficit. Local examination of right inguinal region normal. Local examination of left inguinal region. Multiple enlarged, hard, mobile, horizontal group of inguinal lymph nodes palpable. Bilateral pelvic lymph nodes not palpable. Systemic examination, cardiovascular system, S1, S2 here, respiratory system, bilateral normal vascular presence here, parabolic examination soft, no mass, no organomegaly, CNS clinically normal. Summarizing my case, 60-year-old gentleman came with ulcer over the back of left thigh for past 6 months. Sudden increase in size of ulcer was noted over for past 4 months. Foul smelling discharge from the ulcer present. On examination, irregular ulcer of size, 20 cm into 10 cm with irregular margin. Rolled out edge, floor covered with granulation tissue and slough with indurated base and edge. 1 cm surrounding skin from the edge is also indurated with hyperpigmented patch and satellite nodule surrounding the ulcer. Hard, mobile, multiple, enlarged left superficial inguinal group of nodes noted. My provisional diagnosis, malignant ulcer left thigh, probably squamous cell carcinoma with secondary infection and ipsilateral inguinal node metastasis.
Thank you.
want to make one comment regarding your presentation, Dr. Kavi. You should go a bit more slower. At least I couldn't keep up with the pace of your presentation.
Go through the slides once again.
Agree with that. Very fast.
And whatever points you're saying, make it clear, loud, and very, very, very convincing. That's about your general presentation. Right? Regarding one or two points you mentioned before going to the discussion regarding that, two things I would have loved if you had. See, you just passingly mentioned that there are satellite nodules around the lesion. But after that, in your inspection, you mentioned that. But after that, I never got anything from you regarding the nature of the satellite nodules, distance of the satellite nodules, or the farthest satellite nodule from the edges of the ulcer. Because all these factors are very important for me when if I'm planning a surgical resection, if at all. So in the inspection, you mentioned there are satellite nodules, multiple vaguely, but you never said anything regarding those in a palpation, or you never mentioned regarding the numbers, multiple vague term. I would like to have more information regarding the number of satellite nodules, the consistency of the satellite nodules, and the distance of the satellite, especially the farthest satellite nodule from the edges of the lesion. That's one thing. Second thing, I would have loved to have more information regarding the, again, you passingly mentioned multiple hard nodules in the inguinal region and concluded that they are metastasis. I would have loved to have information about the size of the largest nodule and mobile. Okay, you mentioned that's mobile, but some more information you should be giving regarding the lymph nodes as well. So these are the two areas I would have loved to have more information as far as the presentation is concerned. Regarding the discussion part, we'll come to it later. That's two of my observations. Over to you.
Dr. Kavi Prabha, can you put that inspection slide and again, just put one inspection slide. Yeah. So. Most of the information, whatever given is fine. Extension, we are told, gluteal fold, all that we are told. You mentioned about hypopigmented patch. What is that?
It is a healed scar, sir. Healed area of ulcer, sir.
My interest is why should malignant ulcer heal? You know?
It may be...
So, was there any scar in this patient? That was my interest. That's all.
Previously, there was no scar, sir.
Because moment you have written hypopigmented patch of 5 centimeter size, where is that? Can you show the ulcer again and pinpoint? Do you think that is a healing? Which malignant ulcer has got capacity to heal? Can you tell me?
Malignant ulcers won't heal, sir, but it can be a Marjolin's ulcer, sir.
What Marjolin's ulcer? See, basal cell carcinoma can be sometimes, you know, they can form a crust formation with some amount of healing. But this is not at all the site for that. You understand? So there could be a definite some pre-malignant lesion there, which has precipitated. This is my observation. You said that hypopigmented patch. Okay. Second thing is that palpation slide. Can you put it? That palpation. Dr. Kavi Prabha, palpation slide.
The palpation slide.
That one slide. Just show me once. Yeah. I just want to know extent you have told me all that is correct, but did you mention about mobility? Ulcer is not mobile over underlay. What is the structure which you have tested?
Sir, I have tested for hamstring muscles, sir.
Hamstring? Where?
Sir, I asked the patient to flex against the resistance, the wrist. That's the knee against resistance, and then I place my thumb and index finger over the edges of the ulcer, and then I try to move the ulcer, sir. The ulcer didn't move.
There's a disturbance there. I don't know who is. Lot of disturbance. I can't hear only. You need to check for the mobility when you contract and when you relax the muscles. And any.
To check the fixity to the muscle, I should ask the patient to flex against resistance to see against the contraction, sir.
While flexing, this mobility restricted in your case, is it?
Yes, sir.
What muscle is causing flexion? What is extension? What tests you have done in this patient?
The muscles causing flexion of knee are semimembranous, semitendinous, biceps femoris, sir.
That will come here, is it?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Kavi, did you look for the popliteal nodes here?
Sir. No,
did you
sir.
Check for the popliteal nodes?
No, sir.
You know, your tumor which is there within the period of 6 months, it has become such a large one. So it's really a very rapid growing tumor which is there. And it having the multiple satellite nodules. So either probably this patient has got, you know, the what you see as a white scarred area in between. It was there probably, if your history is correct, then we accept that. But from the look, it looks that it has come out from that scarred area. Or another possibility in this patient with such a big is there, then we have to think of the melanoma also here. That it may be like a superficial spreading type melanoma, which is there with the multiple satellite nodule with multiple lymph nodes, which are fixed to the inguinal area. I think that possibility has also to be kept in this patient.
Yes, sir.
Are you sure there was no scar beforehand?
No, sir.
It has come de novo?
Sir, it has come as a blister and then blister broke down and it develops into ulcer, sir.
Can I come in, sir?
Please, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Kavi, sticking to the mobility, again, I think you're a bit vague here. Mobile, fix not mobile over underlying structures. You mean what is it that you're meaning? It fixes a muscle or something?
Sir, the underlying structure is muscle only, right, sir? Muscle and bone, sir.
See, again, when you're presenting, that part came out only when Rajagopal, sir, probed again. When you say the mobility, you should say that it is mobile or not mobile, and fixed to underlying structures is not what is expected. You should say fixed to muscle, because there are many. I want to know whether it's fixed to the bone or not.
Okay.
So it is. So you have to say that it is fixed to the muscle, because when you moved in one particular, when the muscle was relaxed and you examined, it was mobile. But when the muscle was contracted, the lesion became restricted mobility. So it is fixed to the muscle. So that part should come out more clearly in the presentation rather than vaguely saying that it is fixed to the underlying structures. No, there are many other underlying structures like bone is there.
Yes,
right?
Okay.
Fine.
Nerve, what about the nerve? Did you mention about neurological, sciatica?
Yes, sir, I have mentioned, sir. No sensorineural deficit, sir.
Kavi, what is the satellite nodule?
Sir, it is a cutaneous or subcutaneous spread of carcinoma, which is within the 2 centimeters from the margin of ulcer, sir.
Where is it commonly seen?
Sir, it is usually seen in melanoma, sir.
Okay. So, what is an intransit lesion?
Intransit lesion is a intralymphatic spread of tumor, sir, within the regional lymph node basin.
How do you differentiate from a satellite nodule?
Sir, it is 2 centimeters away from the skin margin, sir, usually.
Any dermal or subdermal deposits within 2 centimeters is satellite, beyond 2 centimeters in transit.
Yes, sir.
Kavi,
Yes, sir.
I would have liked had you examined the muscles a bit more closely, because I don't know. It can be a. There are a lot of things going in my mind seeing this case. It could be a sarcoma which is ulcerated. It could be a tubercular ulcer. There's so many things which are going on in my mind seeing this with such a short history and nothing. We're not getting. There's something missing in this whole thing, which is there's a missing piece somewhere, which we are trying to find out. So okay, let's see how things go.
Dr. Kavi, just a comment on this particular slide. If I say that this is a probable AV malformation, which is probably an ulcer, which has you've said that it bleeds on touch. What are the points which you can say that it's against AV malformation, which is probably ulcerated?
Sir, the edge of the ulcer is rolled out and averted, sir. It won't be like that in AV malformation, sir. AV malformation, sir. And then there won't be any satellite nodules.
Maybe it has been there for a long time and then it's become malignant. So what are the findings clinically would you see in a AV malformation which has ulcerated and which bleeds?
Sir, thrill, sir. Palpable thrill.
Okay. Yeah, that's palpable thrill. And before you palpate the thrill itself, what would you find?
Don't know, sir.
There will be increased warmth of the limb.
Okay, sir.
There will be increased warmth of the limb. And then compared to the opposite side, if it is a arteriovenous malformation, there will be limb girth, which is obviously increased on the opposite side. And definitely distally, if there is extent of venous involvement is higher, then you can get downstream changes where there is venous hyper. So always we need to compare it with the other limb.
Okay, sir.
And on auscultation, there will definitely be a bruit. So these are just pointers. If suppose suddenly the examiner asks you that what, you know, sometimes they can go a little lateral and they can point that, could it be a, because you said it bleeds on touch, could it be a arteriovenous malformation? Then you should be prepared to answer that. These are the points which are against it. Thank you.
Can you move on, sir? Rajagopal, sir?
Yeah, I think so.
Can we come to diagnosis, please?
Yes, sir.
Just one or two things. You mentioned about horizontal nodes and then mentioned pelvic nodes. What did you mean by pelvic nodes? What did you examine actually?
Sir, I examined for any mass in the pelvic region. Both
pilot. What is that?
The iliac nodes, sir. Iliac nodes.
Say that. So what is that thing which you need to mention is iliac nodes. Because when you say pelvic nodes, then we also mean something else also. Obturator nodes are also there. So just above the inguinal ligament, same continuation of that whatever midline. So you thin patients, you should be able to feel the iliac nodes. Okay. That's what you need to mention. And abdomen, anything else you need to look, especially satellite nodules with all these things. There is a rapidly growing, if you suspect melanoma, what else you suspect in the palpate in the abdomen?
Liver enlargement. I should look for liver enlargement, sir.
Anything else? How the liver feels like?
Sir, nodular liver will be
fine. Anything else in the abdomen after the iliac nodes? Something else? Some other masses? Some other masses?
Para-aortic nodes, sir.
Where do you feel that? Large para-aortic nodes? Which quadrant of the abdomen you feel?
It should be felt just above.
Yes. You are there?
You are disconnected, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir, my interconnection.
No problem. So it's more, it's high up. It can be epigastrium.
Sir, para-aortic node should be palpated.
Epigastrium. Okay. So yes, like pseudocyst node, one of the things which you keep it in mind in that area. So all this information to be given, especially I think every one of us are thinking why it is squamous cell carcinoma there, why it is so rapidly growing, why satellite nodules in a squamous cell carcinoma. These are the questions which everybody is trying to find out. So So that is why go more detailed examination. That's what we are trying to get, including supraclavicular. I will not be surprised. So you need to give examination that also. Popliteal was also asked to you. Okay, right? So did you mention anywhere the mobile, this sorry, function of the limb? Function? Gait?
The gait is normal, sir.
You have mentioned.
I have mentioned in history, sir. There is no difficulty in walking.
No. That is history. So you need to mention any limb case is given to you, including varicosity, etc. Gait has to be mentioned. Functional disability. All right.
Okay, sir.
So if any, so sensory motor, sensory deficit motor, plus pulse, all that pulse, arterial pulses and lymph nodes function. Limb means these are the things which are required. Okay, right. Yes, right.
Dr. Kavi, do you have any differential diagnosis for this?
Sir,
can you speak louder?
My first differential diagnosis, marginal incisor, sir. And superficial spreading type of malignant melanoma, sir.
Which do you prefer to put first? Because you said no ulcer, no history of any surgery, no scar. Then why did you bring in marginal ulcer first? Why don't you bring in superficial spreading melanoma? Because of satellite nodules, other thing, why can't you bring that one as the first one rather than marginal ulcer? Sorry, Madhu.
Yes, sir. Marginal, what is the peculiar to marginal ulcer?
Sir, there is no lymphatic spread in the margin.
No, even before that, margin, so it's a chronic ulcer, no?
Chronic ulcer.
Yeah. Chronic means how chronic should it be to become a malignant? Your 4 months, 6 months history won't justify the chronicity of a margin ulcer turning malignancy developing in a margin ulcer. It's much, much more than that. Second, what is the second point you're telling?
The superficial spreading type of...
regarding the lymphatic spread in marginal ulcer.
Sir, lymphatic spread is not there in the marginal ulcer because it develops from the scar tissue. But if a tumor spreads into normal skin, it can spread to a regional lymph node and then...
Yeah, you're right. The concept is that the trauma or the chronicity of the trauma would have destroyed the lymphatic. So as long as the tumor is within that chronic ulcer area, you won't have lymphatic spread. But once it breaches and extends into the normal area, you get access to the lymphatics. But again, I would put it as Raju sir said, it as a superficial spreading melanoma with the satellite nodule. But there are points against that. What would be that? What would the point against a melanoma in this patient?
Pre-malignant lesion, sir.
No. If your deficient diagnosis is malignant melanoma superficial spreading, what would be the point against that? You would have some points against. Otherwise,
lymph nodes, sir.
Lymph nodes are very common in melanoma, sir. Absence of pigmentation.
Pigmentation will be there, sir.
Yeah. Absence of pigmentation is one point which, if this was a pigmented lesion, and you would have put it as melanoma.
Yes, sir.
Right. There are no pigmentation. That's one reason why you might have put squamous cell carcinoma as other lesion.
Yes, sir.
Any other differential diagnosis? Any sarcomas plus can present as cutaneous manifestations? Angiosarcomas? Kaposi's sarcomas? Right? Angiosarcomas and Kaposi's sarcomas can present as cutaneous lesions. But only point is that they would have some preceding history of a nodularity, which may have been the initiating event. They don't just present as ulcer. Usually there will be a nodule which breaches into a ulcer and that. So I would put squamous first, melanoma second, maybe Kaposi's or angiosarcoma third and fourth, and probably last, as you said, something like a marginal ulcer, etc. Sir.
Dr. Kavi Prabha, what about the tuberculosis since that issue has been raised? What are the cutaneous manifestations of tuberculosis? Any idea?
Yes, sir. Lupus vulgaris.
Yes. What do you mean by that? When you call. Yes.
It is a cutaneous manifestation of TB, which will most commonly occur over face. Sir.
Yes, correct. So, what about the rest of the portions? So, tuberculosis can affect even in the normal skin areas as a warty lesion also, as a nodule or some kind of a ulcer which is not healing also. So, these are the possibilities which are considered here, or because it's a bit of, you know, unusual presentation. That is why. So, that's what we expect from you. One is epithelioma, that's a squamous cell carcinoma, and amelanotic melanoma. I think that also discussion has been taken place here. And chronic non-healing ulcer in Indian scenario, yes, but even though it may not look like tuberculosis, but keep it in mind. And other diagnosis, Dr. Madhu has already mentioned about the deep-seated tumor which is coming out like that. Even though we are not feeling anything at the depth, nodules or something. Yes.
Professor Ramanuj Mukherjee has come join. Welcome, sir.
Hi, sir. Very good evening, everyone.
Good evening, sir. Please, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Sir, you can.
Hi, sir. Good evening, sir.
Hi, sir.
Good evening. Good evening.
Any questions, sir? From your.
No, I think, sir, it was a good discussion. I was listening to the discussion. I joined
May
the
I
last
ask one question? Please, sir.
Kavi.
Yes, sir.
Usually, lymphatics spread to the vertical group of lymph nodes. Yes, sir. No?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Usually, lower limb.
You have mentioned about the horizontal group of lymph nodes. I mean, enlargement of horizontal group of lymph nodes. Can you explain?
I didn't know the reason, sir. I examined both the vertical and horizontal group of nodes, sir. In this patient, horizontal group of node only enlarged, sir.
Why we have to examine this lymph nodes in the case of squamous cell carcinoma? What is the purpose behind it?
So the management will change, sir. If
that is, you are hitting somewhere near the bush. Come to the bullseye.
Answer, sir, please.
Actually, when you deal with such a case, we have to deal with the nodes also. We have to go for a ilioinguinal block dissection. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Actually, the disease, there is a primary. From there, it goes to the lymph nodes. From there, it may go to the distant metastasis. When there is no distant metastasis, when there is no M1, we have to plan for a radical surgery. So in that case, we have to deal with the lymph nodes also. Yes?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
No, Jay Khanna, sir.
Okay, so how you are going to proceed with your diagnosis? How you are going to confirm your diagnosis?
Yes, sir. To confirm my diagnosis, I will do incisional biopsy from the edge of the ulcer. And then to support my diagnosis, I will do MRI of the left lower limb, and then ultrasound, and to stage the disease, I will do ultrasound of the left inguinal region, and X-ray chest, X-ray of the local part.
First, tell in the biopsy, what are the different types of biopsies you can take in this patient?
Sir, since it is a large lesion, I incisional biopsy from the edge, sir.
So one is the incisional biopsy. Any other biopsy which you can take?
Punch biopsy, sir.
Hmm?
Punch biopsy.
Punch biopsy. Yes, it's a serrated lesion. You can take a punch biopsy. Now, what the tissue it should contain? Any biopsy which is there? What should be there in that?
It should contain normal skin and then ulcerated area, sir.
Where is the normal skin? What is that
normal
called?
Normal skin around the margin.
do you think the margin is a normal skin or it's abnormal skin? What is the difference between the margin and the edge?
Sir, edge is between floor and margin, sir. Margin is a defined border of the ulcer, sir.
So the surrounding skin which is there is the margin, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So that would be normal?
Sir, we should take edge of the ulcer with the surrounding
with the
skin.
With the margin. With the margin. So margin will contain the normal part, edge and the floor which will be there, it will have the abnormal part. So all the things should be there. And what do you expect? What biopsy will come out in this patient? And how will you say it is a carcinoma or it's a melanoma?
Immunohistochemistry, sir.
No. Ordinary histology. First, the ordinary histology will be done.
Yes, sir. In HP histopathological examination, it can... the differentiation grade of the tumor can be...
Now, how will you say it is a melanoma or how will you say it is a...
Sir, in squamous cell carcinoma, there will be epithelial pearls, sir.
Keratin pearls.
Yes, sir.
And in melanoma?
In melanoma, immature melanocytes will be there, sir.
From where is squamous cell carcinoma arising and from where the melanoma arises?
Sir, squamous cell carcinoma arises from the keratinocytes in the basal layer, sir.
Pardon? Melanoma?
Melanoma from the melanocytes, proliferating melanocytes from the basal layer, sir.
Basal cell carcinoma?
Sir, what is from
prickle cell layer?
Sir?
Prickle cell layer.
Prickle cell layer is a stratum spinosum layer, sir.
So, sir is asking where does squamous arise from, where is basal cell carcinoma arise from?
Basal carcinoma arise from stratum basal, sir. Squamous cell carcinoma arise from keratinocytes in the stratum spinosum, sir. That is prickle cell layer.
What are the different types of melanomas?
Sir, superficial spreading type, nodular, acral lentiginous, lentigo maligna, amelanotic variety, sir.
What is the difference between a superficial spreading and a nodular melanoma?
Superficial spreading type has more horizontal growth, sir. Mm-hmm. In nodular variety, the lesion has more vertical growth.
Okay. So you've done the biopsy in this patient and it has come out to be squamous cell carcinoma. Now, what will be your next investigation?
Sir, to know the extent of the lesion, I will do MRI, sir. Extent of soft tissue involvement, I will do MRI of the left limb, lower limb.
You do not want to do any other biopsy, sir, I will do... or anything in this patient? Apart from the biopsy from the lesion which is there, you are not interested in any other biopsy or cytology or whatever you want to do?
Sir, FNACF the node, sir.
Will you do that or not?
Yes, sir, I will do.
You have to do that, no? To say that that is malignant.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So I was asking about biopsy. What is the difference between a biopsy done in a suspected squamous cell carcinoma and the biopsy being done in a suspected melanoma?
Sir, for melanoma, usually melanoma will be small, sir. So we can go for excision biopsy, sir.
That's not the point. Small, big, that's not the point. Regarding the, see, the point is, you said you should have a the classical biopsy taken as squamous cell carcinoma is edge.
Sir, usually, yes, sir.
Edge-wedge biopsy. That's what the classical term is.
Yes, sir.
Why melanoma, do you have a normal tissue? Because you can get the diagnosis from the abnormal area, then why do you want to include the normal tissue in your biopsy?
Proliferating cells are...
Yeah, see, the first thing is that you should take the biopsy from the most representative area or the most proliferating area of the lesion. Right, so any ulcer, this kind of big ulcer, you take it from somewhere, you will get necrotic tissue. You end up doing a repeat biopsy. So first of all, clinically itself, you should identify a representative area and take a biopsy, including edge of normal tissue. Why normal tissue? Because there is something like infiltrative borders, pushing borders, etc., which are prognostically important, which are surgically also important. So to know the type of the invasive front of an ulcer, whether it's a pushing type of invasive front or an infiltrative type of push, edges, you have to take normal tissue. That's about squamous cell carcinoma. But my question was, what is the difference in taking a biopsy in a melanoma, big melanoma?
Melanoma, the thickness will be variable, sir. We should take a biopsy from the thickest area of the lesion, sir.
The depth is important, my melanoma.
Yes, exactly. The depth is important in your staging.
Yes, sir.
So you take a biopsy, full thickness biopsy, including the deep fascia. Only then you will have a proper T staging done in a melanoma. Okay, right? But that's in matching a squamous cell carcinoma. A squamous cell carcinoma, you should have a abnormal area and normal area to be taken, a wedge biopsy, not go too deep in a squamous cell carcinoma. But in a melanoma, if you take a biopsy, you have to go up to a deep fascia, because the thickness as measured in the histopathology will decide the T status and which subsequently will decide the margins and the nodal resection, etc.
Okay, sir.
So you take an edge wedge biopsy from the most representative area, including the normal skin also, normal skin included, to know the invasive front, right? Again, then you said grading in melanoma, in squamous cell carcinoma. What is the grading that is being used in squamous cell carcinomas? What is it called like? It's called the Broaders grading.
Broaders grading, sir.
Yeah. Do you know what are the different grades of that?
Yes, sir. Grade 1, more than 75% of keratin pulse.
Fine. Agree. Ajay sir, you are asking about investigations.
Yeah. So why you want to do the MRI in this patient? What is your purpose? How it is going to help you?
Sir, to know the exact size of the lesion and then depth of invasion. And then neurovascular bundle involvement.
Which neurovascular bundle are you talking about in this area?
Sciatic nerve.
Know the depth, how deep the sciatic nerve is? Yeah, agree. You need to know the depth of invasion, you need to know the involvement of the adjacent structure. So I agree with you, MRI finding. Ajay sir.
So what advantage you are going to get by that? That's what I was asking.
Sir, with that we can decide about limb sparing surgery is enough, or then we can go for any other surgeries like amputation.
But the bone is not getting involved here, and you know the sciatic nerve is not involved. So you can remove all the muscles which are there from, if you want to go in the depth, you can remove all the muscles from there. Isn't
yes, Dr. Kavi Prabha, for this case, please don't say amputation and all that thing, okay? Because don't apply that principle of MRI, what to do in sarcoma and here. Okay. That is a logic is there. It is totally different. Here also idea is to know how much it has infiltrated depth, but don't use that word amputation. The little wide excision should be your principle. Then it when that further they ask you, those things you need to tell. Be a little careful about that amputation. Don't say that here.
Okay. Then what you will do after that?
Sir, after that I will plan for wide local excision with the...
No. Please. I'm not happy with your investigation part.
Yeah, you have made a diagnosis here.
You have done the diagnosis.
You have to see for the metastatic workup, isn't
it? Yes, sir. For metastatic workup, I will do...
Such an aggressive tumor it is, and you have definitely carried out all the metastatic workup.
Yes, sir. For that, I will do X-ray chest, and then
abdomen.
Ultrasound.
Kavi, what are the things that you want in this description from the perspective? You said local extension, your MRI is okay. But then you said there is a node also. Do you want to know anything more about the node in terms of imaging? If so, what is it that you want to know as far as the nodes are concerned? Primary lesion, I agree. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Primary MRI, I agree.
Yes, sir, I already told ultrasound left inguinal region, sir.
Why? Why do you want ultrasound of the inguinal region? You have a palpable hard node, which most probably you said is malignant. What else do you want to know?
Sir, with the ultrasound, we can say it is a benign or a malignant node, sir.
Kavi, you already committed that's a hard node, it's a malignant node. And again, yes, Ajay sir pointed out that if you have any doubt, you can take an FNAC and prove it to be malignant or not. Ultrasound is not the one that clinches the malignant. It's FNAC, if at all you're confused regarding the... But your hard node, I would take it as malignant. Imaging should be to further help your management protocol. So if at all you're doing ultrasound or inguinal region, what specifically I'm looking for is the iliac nodes.
Yes, sir.
Fixed CT, again, as you said, some mobile node, I won't mobile be much concerned. If it were a fixed node, I would be concerned about fixed CT to the vascular structures, in the vein or not. But okay, since you specifically said some mobile node, I would do an ultrasound. If at all, that is to look for the iliac nodes.
Yes, sir.
Because clinically, it may not be palpable whether they are enlarged or not radiologically. That's why I would do ilioinguinal ultrasound.
Okay,
that's regarding the local regional imaging. So any imaging, it should include T, N, and M. Then for M part, what will you do?
X-ray chest to rule out the lung mets.
So again, I said this big ulcer, more than 20
centimeters, sir.
Yeah, 20 centimeters large ulcer with a palpable hard node over there. I would be happy with the CT chest. If you ask me to do the investigation, I would say CT chest, abdomen, and pelvis, including the primary area also. So I wouldn't go for MRI of the limb, CT of the abdomen, CT of the chest, ultrasound. I would do a CT, one shot CT, chest, abdomen, pelvis, and upper thigh.
Okay, sir.
Right? In a sarcoma, you would go for MRI, as Rajagopal sir was saying. But here, I would be happy with the CT also. CT is not that bad. So if you want me to tell one investigation, CT chest, abdomen, pelvis, including the upper thigh. You show me the primary nodes, pelvic nodes, iliac nodes, liver, lung, etc. That would be my take on the extent of metastatic evaluation. Ajay sir or Ramanuj sir, please come in and...
Okay. So after you have staged the disease, Kavi, what is the stage of the disease clinically that you think?
Sir, it's stage 3 disease, sir.
Okay. What will be the TNM like?
T4A. T4A N1 M0, sir.
Okay. T4A N1 M0. Right. So with this stage of disease and you have done the staging investigations, what is your plan as a surgeon?
Sir, I would like to go for wide local excision with 2 cm three-dimensional margin and okay, then ilioinguinal block dissection, sir.
Okay, Kavi, just a minute. See, in this modern era and in this era, it is better to think not only of as a surgeon. This is the trick in the question.
Multidisciplinary.
It is better than, exactly. So, rather than thinking only as a surgeon, this is the trick that the examiner wants to you to fall into. You will say that, sir, it is better to discuss this as a part of a multidisciplinary team meeting or a tumor board meeting, which will consist of, can you name what are the disciplines that you will be calling?
Sir, radiologist. Pathologist, okay. Oncologist, sir.
Pathologist and oncologist, come on. You have only 3 cups of coffee, Kavi. So what are the cups of coffee, or who are you going to call? Come on, why do you need the radiologist and the pathologist, tell me? They are going to have your cup of coffee and they are going to go away. So why do you need them? Hello? Did you get the question?
Sir.
You see,
yes, sir.
In a multidisciplinary team, you always call people who are going to influence your treatment. Okay? So that means yes, you are requiring, you will be requiring a medical oncology to guide you into neoadjuvant and adjuvant chemotherapy, yes, and a radiation oncology to plan. Maybe you will also require the help of a plastic and a reconstructive surgeon with the large defect that may be produced for a reconstruction. Okay? So then comes your surgical management. Right? I think that this is the discussion. Madhu, any more points on this one?
Yeah, I'll take it from where you ended. See, when yeah, Raman sir asked you regarding what will you do for the patient, you jumped and said wide local excision. Again, that would not be the right way. You should assess it. You should put in a tumor board and then take a call on that.
Mm-hmm.
But it is in this context that, Kabir, that my initial question becomes important. You said there are satellite nodules around the lesion. I just mentioned wide local excision. So this is the point where I would like to know what is the spread of that satellite nodules. I need to map that. Do you think that satellite nodules are significant?
Yes, sir.
How far away they are from the primary tumor? Or the farthest one? Do you want to put separate incisions or include all in the same incision?
Since it is close to the margin, we can put a including incision. We can include both the satellite nodule and the ulcer, sir.
You're a fine layer PG. Have you thought of the type of incision you're going to put in that particular case? The image is not there, but still. You're a fine layer PG. You shouldn't be knowing how would you put the incision in that patient, including the entire lesion and the satellite nodules. And then how would you cover the lesion? As Raman said, you just can't escape by saying that I do a wide excision. You have to do a wide excision.
The defect will be large only, sir. To close the defect, we can use some flaps.
Again, another basic question. How would you position this patient? You said wide local excision of a lesion on the posterior part of the thigh and an ileum blocked excision, which is on the anterior part of the thigh. How would you position this patient for surgery?
First, I will put the patient in the prone position. I will do wide local excision and then I will turn the patient to supine and then I will do the ileum blocked
excision. I just wanted you to think about all this possible because you are a final PG in another couple of months. You would go out of the institute and start practicing. So you should have, when you jump into surgery, you should have all this in your mind. How would you position the patient? It's a difficult case. And you should get the help of your microvascular or a plastic surgery team to cover the lesion. Will you put a skin graft over there?
Yes, sir. We can put a split skin graft over the defect, sir.
Kavi, you are exactly falling in the traps that we are laying for you.
Or we can go for free flap, sir.
No. There is a trap in the question. Why do you specifically ask for a skin graft?
Exactly.
Sir, skin graft has its own disadvantage, sir. If we give radiation over the skin graft region, can again ulcerate, sir.
Yeah, in a malignancy where you expect the patient to be a potential candidate for adjuvant radiation, in case the margin turns out to be positive or something, you should skin graft would be the last sort of reconstruction, any oncological reconstructions. You would like to bring tissue over, vascularized tissue over. And second, you said wide excision, how wide?
2 centimeter wide, sir. 2 centimeter wide from the edge of the ulcer, all around, sir, including depth.
Kavi, your lesion is 20 centimeter by 16 centimeters.
20, sir.
20 by 20 centimeters. So you have to go around 1 to 2 centimeter all around that. So that will come to 22 by 22 centimeters, or in fact 24 by 24 centimeters. If you go 2 centimeters all around. Now tell which free flap will come of the size of 24 by 24 centimeters.
Sir, anterolateral thigh free flap from the opposite thigh, sir.
Based on which artery?
Lateral circumflex femoral artery.
You can get such a big flap from that? It is a huge flap, huge free flap, you know?
Yes, sir.
24 by 24 centimeters.
a huge, what you say, anterior ALT flap with some parts of the defect may be closed primarily, and the remaining part you will have to bring in a large ALT. Regarding the ilioangle,
you know, I was just wondering, why not put a skin graft here? What is the problem in that, sir? This is in the thigh area, which is not crossing any joint. Except the patient.
If the margins are positive, we should give radiation, sir. If we put SSG, it can make problems. It can make complications.
You know, Kavi, in a desperate situation, even though I mentioned the skin graft are normally not preferred, in a desperate situations, you may be forced to put it, because if the ALT is not large enough, you'll put the ALT and the remaining area, you will graft it off. Only thing is that you should make sure that this patient won't be a candidate for radiation by the margin positivity. How would you do that? How can you make sure that the margins
frozen
are negative?
Frozen section, sir.
A frozen section in areas where you think the margins are close, and make sure that the margins are negative, and then bring in a huge ALT and bring cover with some skin graft. Or skin grafts are not an absolute no-no. It can be put, but it should not be irradiated.
Okay, sir.
So if you come out to be after 6 months, there is recurrence is there at the margins. What are you going to do?
So for recurrence also, I will opt for surgical management, sir.
Surgical management, if it is possible to operate, definitely you should go for that rather than relying on only on the radiotherapy. Yeah, I do agree with you. Yeah.
We just one question regarding the management. You said you will do an ilioangle block dissection.
Yes, sir.
Tell me, what are the components of the surgery?
Sir, first we should raise the flaps. Its upper limit up to 6 to 7 centimeter above the inguinal ligament, and then below.
I'm not asking the steps of surgery. Which are the lymph nodal groups that you'll remove?
Sir, superficial inguinal nodes, sir. I will send it for frozen section. If it is involved, we should remove deep inguinal nodes also, sir. If deep inguinal node is involved, I will go for iliac node dissection, sir.
This patient, I would say, if radiologically or intraoperatively you find that the nodes are involved, you'll have to go for iliac node dissection.
What was done to this patient? You saw this patient, isn't it, postoperatively? Can you tell them what was done? And had you
seen? Yes, sir.
What was done to the patient? Kindly brief them. You have seen the case.
Sir,
isn't
as
it?
Madhu sir told, ALT flap with partial SSG was put over the ulcer, sir. Put over the wide local excision area, sir. And
over the ulcer or before excision? First, what was done?
After excision.
Yeah, tell that first.
The oncologist. After excision, surgical oncologist did ALT flap with the SSG, sir, and then ilioinguinal block dissection, sir.
Right. And did you have a follow up? Almost 3-4 months happened. This patient.
What was done for the nodal stations?
Nodal station, yes.
That I already mentioned, sir. Ilioinguinal block dissection.
No, you don't say already mentioned. When somebody is asking a question in the forum, it's like an exam.
It's okay.
Can you say this? You can get, repeat it, ma. Repeat it, please, sir. This will, you'll do it in the exam. I already mentioned the examiners will get while there is a senior exam. So you said what you told, you tell them. What was done?
There was a iliac nodal dissection also done. That was my only question.
Sir, iliac nodal dissection also done, sir.
Have the final histopathology report of the margins and everything?
I didn't know, sir. I will enter and let you know, sir.
What are the complications of ilioinguinal block dissection?
Flap necrosis.
What are the ways to cover the flap necrosis? How can you prevent that?
Oh no, sir.
What is the incision you put for ilioinguinal block dissection?
What incision was put for this particular patient?
Well, sir.
Okay, probably not followed the surgery, I think.
What was the incision? What is the incision usually followed?
I forget the name, sir.
Pardon? Fine. What happens if skin necrosis, skin goes in for flap, skin for necrosis, or the flap goes in for, what happens? Okay, we don't waste time. See, you have dissected the inguinal ridge and you left behind the vessels over there. So when the skin necrosis or the flaps necrose, what happens is the vessels are exposed. So you're worried about the exposed vessels. What do you do to prevent that?
During surgery,
if femoral vessels are exposed, what will you do? What was done? Will you use anything to cover it?
Yeah, bring something and cover the femoral vessels so that even if the skin goes off, the femoral vessels are not exposed. So what can be brought and placed over the femoral vessels?
What is Taylor muscle?
Sartorius, sir.
Yeah, it's called sartorius transposition. Whenever you do inguinal block dissection, irrespective of whether your skin is good or bad or whatever it is, you bring the sartorius and cover the femoral vessels to protect it from a situation from those getting exposed. So even if a flap is necrosed, you are at least safe that the vessels are covered and you don't have bleeding from there. So it has to go for a sartorius transposition.
Okay, sir.
Karnar, sir, you wanted to ask something?
Sir, I will ask a small one.
Please,
okay,
sir.
What are the risk factors for recurrence of sarcoma? Because we have been discussing about recurrence and radiotherapy. What are the risk factors or high risk factors that can produce a recurrence in a squamous cell carcinoma?
Sir, if the tumor is high grade and then the tumor size is more than 2 cm.
Okay, so let us have them. So let us have clinical and let us have pathological features. Okay, now, yes, so what are the clinical locations where squamous cell cancer has a higher chance of recurrence? And if you know of any size on that area?
Sir, ear, lips, hand.
Okay, so let us not waste time. Remember that if it is in the... Okay, I will ask you another, or say an indirect one. Say the cancer is squamous cell cancer in the face, is squamous cell cancer in the limb. Which one is a higher chance of a recurrence?
Face, sir.
Definitely, because remember that particularly nowadays we classify all squamous cell carcinomas by something called the LMH location wise. Okay, so if it is in the limb, if it is more than 20 millimeter, it falls under a high risk of recurrence. In the face, however, particularly the area that we wear our mask every day, and in also the pre-tibial area, remember that if the size is more than 10 millimeter, so that is a small difference. Okay. So it has recurrence. The rest of the things are something that you have said, pathology, immunosuppression, and those things. Okay?
Okay, right. Sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
May I ask one question?
Yes, sir.
Yes, already have asked you the question, why the horizontal group has evolved. Am I?
You are, sir.
Yes. Actually, the tumor has spread up to the gluteal region and gluteal cleft and all. Those areas drain to the horizontal group of lymph nodes, whereas the vertical portion of the limb drains to the vertical group of lymph nodes. That's why you've got a horizontal group of lymph nodes. Do you find any difficulty in doing surgery in, ileoinguinal block dissection with this kind of hard nodes?
Sir?
Have you ever seen a inguinal block dissection or
No, sir. I didn't see the.
You have not?
No, sir.
Is Suresh Venkatachalam, sir, is there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. He is the HOD of RCC Coimbatore.
He might be doing.
No, they are doing, sir. Probably she missed it. Probably that time when she went, there was no case. That case was not there or something.
Okay, thank you.
Ajay Khanna, sir, please. Madhu, sir.
You know, for for prevention of the flap necrosis, what I ask you, one is that you do not raise too much of the flaps.
Yes, sir.
Second is the thickness of the flap should be good. Third is you can make elliptical incision over the central part so that that area goes that is discarded so that you do not raise too much of the flap.
Yes, sir.
Then you should always try to avoid the infection in that area as far as possible. And also the lymphoria. If the lymphoria is there, then that, so that is a, you have to almost ligate all the lymphatics which are there. I mean, they should be ligated if they, because there are a lot of the lymphatics which are there. So they should be, apart from just burning them with the electricity, you have to ligate them to prevent the lymphoria. So if you do, and then you have to, for the femoral blowout, you have to bring the sartorius muscle over that. So all those things has to be kept in mind to prevent the flap necrosis. And then you can make the parallel incision. Sometimes, you know, especially if there is the post radiation is there, you can make the parallel, like you can make in the neck the parallel incision. Similarly, you can also make in the inguinal area also the parallel incision, two parallel incision with a puddle of the skin in between.
Yes, sir.
Madhu sir, a question.
I agree with most of the points that you very, very, very practical points that regarding the flap raising, the plane of the flap, taking away the edges of the skin before suturing. Avoiding cautery, avoiding seroma formation, and all, especially the medial flap is the one that goes. So be very careful when you raise the medial flap. And again, there are two types of incision. One is the LACS incision, a single incision through which you access the iliac as well as the inguinal nodes. Or you can go for two parallel incisions. Upper incision above the inguinal ligament, maybe 2 to 3 centimeters above the inguinal ligament through which you access the iliac nodes. And another incision parallel to the inguinal ligament, maybe 3 centimeters below the inguinal crease through which you access the, the inguinal nodes. And again, you should know the boundaries of dissection also. What are the boundaries of an inguinal dissection? What are the boundaries of an iliac dissection? Time may be a concern, so we won't go into that. So just for curious, let me ask you one last question. If this patient has got a liver metastasis, maybe 1 or 2 picked up on the CT scan or a 1 metastasis picked up on the X-ray chest or CT chest, what would you do?
Sir, I will go for systemic chemotherapy, sir.
I don't know whether all the panelists would agree with me. Still, I think I would operate this patient because his problem is the ulcer. And squamous cell carcinomas are not very sensitive to any sort of chemotherapy. So at least a palliative the surgery I would do for this patient, even if it's, I'm talking about a not a symptomatic metastatic patient, a metastasis picked up on CT, chest or abdomen. So that ulcer has to come out. His life is going to miss it. So a palliative resection also, excision would also be justifiable, but I there may be difference of opinion. I'm open to that. So that would be my last question.
Question to you is, if this patient has come with a recurrence, a small recurrence, what will you do? Or if the patient has come with a recurrence which is huge enough to become an ulcer again, if a patient is not minded, is there a change of treatment? Small recurrence and a large recurrence.
Sir, if it is small, I will go for...
This question I request, I wanted to clarify from Madhu, sir.
Okay, sir.
Again, as Ajay sir, I think this point was discussed, I think irrespective of the nature of the recurrence, you look at two things, sir. One is the resectability. If it's a resectable, you resect it. Second is how fast it has recurred. So if it has but still, however fast it has recurred, whatever the size it may be, if it's a resectable recurrence, the best option would be to resect, sir. Yes. But the prognosis is going to be bad. If the patient has recurred within 1 month, then the prognosis is bad rather than a patient who has recurred after 2 years. So that will help in PROC, but I would say any recurrence resectable should go for a resection. Ajay sir, or any opinion, sir?
I agree with you, Madhu. That is because these are local recurrence, including, say, for example, some fibromatosis, some desmoids, some cases of, you know, papillary carcinoma of the lymph nodes. Sometimes what happens is you order a function, somewhere one node sometimes appears. So they are all slow growing tumor. Better to resect it whenever possible.
rather than subjecting them. Of course, if it does not harm functional disability of the limb, whatever resection which we are, suppose it amounts to something else, then probably then I think we need to give alternate therapy.
As Rajagopal sir said, you should never ever think about amputation. You loosely brought the term limb salvage. You should not bring in that. Squamous cell carcinomas are cutaneous malignancy. However deep they go, they won't infiltrate usually the bone and all. So you will be able to salvage the limb even if recurs. The picture will be different if it's a soft tissue sarcoma.
Yes.
And I will, sir.
I would say, I would request Kavi Prabhat to ask any doubts should she have with the faculty, all the national faculty is there for you to take any clarifications, Kavi.
Sir, she presented this case in the national forum at Gurukulcon and got the third prize from Professor Shintamani. She's got a scholar for Royal College of Surgeons. Scholarship, sir. Congrats, Kavi.
That's good. So that's the good news.
Yes, sir. When Professor Chintamani is Gurukulcon, she got the third prize in the PG.
Yes, I remember. Okay. I thought she had performed very well then. This time I think she slipped, but it was she had performed very well then.
Thank you, sir.
I think our forum is tougher than any other forum, I think, sir. Our fact.
But she had performed very well then.
But there also, Professor Rajiv sir was there. Ramanuj sir was there, Professor Chintamani was there.
Not the question of toughness, but the extensive the duration of our class brings out all the lacuna and all the difficult points. That's an advantage.
There the integrated... time was limited, sir. We can move to the next case, sir.
Yes, sir.
Ajay Kana, sir.
No, it's okay. Yeah, absolutely.
Yes, sir.
Everything, yeah.
Thank you, sir. Rajagopal, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Can we move on to the next case, sir? Any comments you want to make, sir?
No, nothing.
Madhu, sir, any closing comments, sir?
Nothing. Only thing is that I just want to clarify one last thing regarding any adjuvant therapy would you use in this patient?
Sir, we can give adjuvant
radiotherapy. It's not you can. Will you give any adjuvant therapy?
Sir, adjuvant radiotherapy can be given, sir, if...
For all patients or in a very specific situation?
If a margin positive tumor or a perineural or lymphovascular invasion is there, we can go for it.
If there are any poor prognostic factors like your unfortunate margin being positive or not showing extra capsular spread or perineal, you can give. But generally, if you have done a good wide excision and good nodal dissection, squamous cell carcinomas of the extremity do not have any major indications for adjuvant chemotherapy or radiotherapy. So just don't say that you will give chemotherapy. You can give chemotherapy. Be very clear about that. If the margins are negative and there are no poor prognostic factors, you need not give any adjuvant therapy for the primary site or even for the nodal stations.
I have one doubt, sir. Sir, is there any role of curative RT in squamous cell carcinoma, sir? Curative radiotherapy in small size lesion or else anything, sir?
Small size lesions, why should you think in terms of a curative radiotherapy when you can operate that patient? Can you give me the scenario?
Sir, the patient is not fit for surgery.
When he's not fit for surgery, he cannot withstand the curative RT also.
I have read about curative RT in my book, sir. That's why I am.
Ajay sir was saying
Ajay
something.
Ajay sir is answering.
No, like sometimes in the organ preservation, no? Like a cancer of the penis is there, the small lesion which is there, you can cure it by the radiotherapy. Instead of going for the amputation and all those, you can cure it.
Yeah, probably penile squamous cell carcinoma confined to the glands or in situ carcinomas or areas where your mild radiotherapy can be given. Otherwise, extremity squamous cell carcinomas, you would generally prefer, because see, the patient is unfit for surgery. See, the extremity squamous cell carcinomas can be done under spinal anesthesia, so your anesthesia won't be a major issue over there. Unless
okay, sir.
Elderly guy, moribund patient. I would always go for surgery for this patient.
Madhu sir, there's a question. Sir. What are the implications for amputation in a case of squamous cell carcinoma? Somebody's
asked. For that matter, sir, amputation. Yeah, any limb that can be salvaged should be salvaged, because now you have got, see, your indications for amputation was inability to get a cover, inability to have a functional limb. Now that you have plastic surgical options to cover any big wounds, you have vascular reconstruction. Even if it's infiltrating the bone, you can resect that segment of the bone and replace it. So today, the indications for amputations, at least above knee lesions, below knee lesions are different, by ankle lesions are different ballgame. So they are getting a cover, etc., with functionality of the limb. So if you can have a reasonably functional limb with reconstruction of the with flaps, reconstruction of the vessels, reconstruction of the bone, amputation should be one of the last options. So in squamous cell carcinoma, definitely very rarely, unless you have multiple recurrences, huge recurrences, non-salvageable, non-functional limb, below knee amputation maybe. For example, a huge altered ankle area, you don't have a recipient vessel to bring in a flap. If you have, you can bring in a flap only if there is a recipient vessel to anastomose it. So even if there is no recipient vessel to get the flap inserted, then you are in trouble. So if a flap can be brought in, if the vessels can be reconstructed, if the bone can be resected, the limb has to be salvaged. So.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
I think postgraduate should remember not to tell it. Even for an osteogenic sarcoma of the femur, there's a limb preservation. So I think with so much modalities of treatment available,
Total femur is being replaced.
So I think we should not mention that.
Thank you, sir. Madhu, sir, I would still request you to stay back for the next case. It's a pure and pure vascular case, not oncology.
It's a vascular case, and you have vascular experts.